Thank you.
Okay, have
okay.
a seat.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Okay. Well, so Daniel and I have long
list of questions.
We spent some time together kind of talking about this, and we really want to just start by having you tell us a little bit about who you are and your entrepreneurial journey and how you eventually landed here.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'm Daniel Wang. That's my English name. My Chinese name is, I may need to let you know my Chinese name. Wang Jun. That's, I know, very difficult to recall. So just call me Daniel, okay. My background, I was a medical background. I was a doctor. I was an operation surgeon doctor. So that's the reason why I standing with Dan to ask what's the problem about his foot. Yes, I am. I spent 6 years in my medical university. But after my graduation, I feel that I really don't like that. So I just been an operation surgeon about less than one year, about 10 months. And I quit. And then I went to, that's about 94, so I started working for a pharmaceutical company, which is Johnson & Johnson. I'm in charge of this product in China. Because I was medical background. And this is a real good product because after I working for Johnson & Johnson, I never had ache again. But this is real good, okay? And then after working for that, I started working for Colgate Palmolive, toothpaste. And then I'm working for Hoffman & Roche. That's a Swiss company, very big one. This should be about number two or number three Swiss pharmaceutical company. And then I work for Kodak Film, American company, Kodak Film. So for this multinational company, I work for about 14 years. 8 years as a sales, and 6 years as marketing guy. About 2006, I start to do my business. I start from my business about cartoon animation. And then I met my business partner. His name is Glad. He started his business about toy, and then investment on the cartoon, and then we invest on movie. So we met at that time about 26. And then we start our business for the cartoon and real estate business, and then we invest on internet. So about 2013, we come to Muscatine.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. That's a great background start for us. So when we met a couple of weeks ago, you were talking about, you went to medical school, you were a doctor, you were a surgeon, and you said to me, and because we were talking about how did you start your entrepreneurial journey, and you said, you know, you're an innovator, and I wrote this down in quotes, I like to break the rules. So you said there wasn't a lot of room to break the rules in a surgical hospital as a surgeon. Probably a good thing, right, Dan? So what did you learn from those days as a surgeon, as well as your days in multinational corporate sales and marketing? What do you learn from those days that bring you to be an entrepreneur?
Yeah, so it's a very, no. You have to follow the game rule first. And then broken the rule. You have to follow the game rule. And then such as the medical system teaches me a lot. You have to understand, one of the reasons I don't like medical is you have to learn a lot. I'm not kidding. When I graduated from my medical university, I put all of the books together. It's about two times than my tall. You have to learn all of that. So this is something you have to do. And after I work in for the hospital, as the operation surgeon, if I work very hard, at the first year, I'll get about 200 of surgery a year. But next year, I'll have 200 more. But think about it, if I'm the guy to work in the hospital in the first year, I have 200 operating surgeon experience. And next year, I have another 200, that's 400. And the fresh guy coming here, he has 200 experience. Think about it, when the director my boss, he wants to do a big surgery. He wants an assistant. Whom will he pick up? This guy or this guy? This guy. The reason is, this guy has more experience. So when I leave the hospital, my boss told me, he asked me, what is the reason I leave? I don't want to be a doctor. I told him, it's too much bureaucratic in hospital. You have to work it step by step. He said, yes, it is, but it's some reason behind that. Because this guy, he has two times experience than you. For the safety purpose for the patient, my boss has to pick that guy. So innovation at that time, or game rule broken at that time, it's no way. So this makes me feel, well, I have to follow up all of this, process and takes too much long time for my life. And business seems quite different. Business, there's a lots of creative idea coming to mind, and you can do it by yourself and just got it approved by your boss. Because in business, if you fail, it's lost of money. But in medical system, if you fail, there's a loss of life. So that's totally different. So my personal personality may be more fit for the business. But the medical system tell me a lot, because you have to, in medical education background, I be taught to keep asking why. So when the problems comes, you have to why. Why you have this kind of, why, just like you, I ask you then, why? What's the problem about your knee, or foot? This is because of this reason. And why? Why this kind of reason happens to broken your foot? And why? So you have to keep asking the why. As long as you ask a lot of questions, then you can feel the answer of the essential reason of that problem. So this, and then you can find the good medical to treat it. But this is a kind of knowledge what I learned from the medical system. But I think it's also good for my business. When I'm doing my business, I always ask why. Why this kind of business is work, or this idea is work, or not. Okay, you will give some reason to say, okay, this is the reason why it is work. But why your reason is work? That's another why. So when you keep asking why, it will help you to find the essential reason of what is it. And if you got the real reason, I think sometimes you can make it. So this is what I learned.
Okay.
So maybe I need some napkins. So. Oh,
you, no.
Yeah.
You need a.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
Okay. Wow. So you've been. You've been in business on your own.
Yeah.
10 years or so.
Oh yeah.
And now your entrepreneurial journey has brought you from China to Muscatine, Iowa.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Why Muscatine?
Yeah. Oh, this is a very good, big question. but before that, I always I think I'm going to back to your previous question. I think I have quite good business career in this multinational company. But at about 2006, I'm going to start my business. Because at that time, in the previous 14 years, I deal with lots of consumer business, consumer goods. Okay. And if I'm looking about the macroeconomic of China, I can feel in past 20 years, China economic is real dynamic, grows very fast. So I think it's a real good time for me to develop my business, because as an entrepreneur or employee, it's really different. I just show you something about this is the Chinese annual income per capita. Chinese annual income per capita. This is a Chinese currency, but regardless about that, 1990, about 1500. That's about 250 US dollar annual income. 1990. When I worked for the hospital is 1993, my monthly salary is $10 monthly salary. Okay, that's that time. But now, just pick about 2010, that's about 19, which is about 13 times than 20 years before. Think about it. I'm the guy who living in China with this kind of economic growth. I can see, of course, my personal income is grows also very quick because I'm working for this multinational company. And also I can find a lot of people living near me. I know what their life changed. And when people get money, when people get rich, they need to consumption. Any kind of product they need a good product, they need brand product. That's the reason I'm going to sell Tylenol or Colgate. This toothpaste, when I work for this company, this product, the retail price of it, it's about five times than local Chinese product toothpaste. Five times. It is because this is the American brand. So American company make huge money in China. So this is a, so from the macroeconomic study, I believe in this kind of economic growth, it's a real great time for a businessman, not only an employee. So that's the reason why I start my business in the at 2007. Okay. And the result here seems real is also quite good, because in the start from 2006 to now, there's about less than 10 years. I think me and my partner make quite good business success. We invest a couple real estate business. It is good. And we are so lucky to invest on a couple internet company, apps company, about 5 years before. And internet is internet. When you succeed, it's real success, because it's a couple hundred times growth. So after, actually about 2012, my partner and I, we have our professional team to help us to manage our business. So we are not so busy. We start to looking for the next opportunity. And then we think maybe we can go out of China. Because one of my personal experience from these four multinational companies is not only the knowledge or experience. I think the most important is these companies helped me to open my eyes all of China. They help all of my business philosophy is learned by these four companies. They teach me how to do the business in Western style. So they help me to open eyes on world instead of stick on China market only. Eyes on European, eyes on America. So this helped me a lot. So that's the reason why we're coming here. I've been in US a lot of time in different cities. Why Muscatine? Why not Muscatine? Yes, actually, okay. I can tell the difference is my different feeling. I've been in Seattle, New York, Washington, Los Angeles, and lots of different big cities. Oh, don't forget, I'm from Shanghai. I don't even, this is almost the biggest city, just like in New York in US, Shanghai. It's a 25 million population city. I born there, I live in there, so I know very well about what is a big city. And that's the reason why I'm in Seattle, Chicago. I see, okay, everybody told me this is a very big city. I think, okay, but 3 million. It's not something. it's big, but not so big. So I have a lot of experience of big city, but this here, Muscatine, the first time be here, I have to say I like it very much because of the view, because of nature. That's the first impression, just coming here one night and I'm back. But later on coming here, when I meet the friends, the local people, you make me feel part of you. I mean, when I do business in New York or in Seattle or LA, anywhere, we usually meet in a coffee bar or in a restaurant or in the office. In Seattle we always go to Starbucks. But in here, the businessman in here, you invite me to go to their home. You invite me to go to their home to have dinner with them, have lunch with them, to see their family, to see their pet, to see their dogs. It's good. You made me feel difference. I've been Europe. I've been in lots of countries. Usually, businessman to businessman, that's a very kind of social. I invite you to have a dinner, blah, blah, blah. But here, it's real different. And of course, Muscatine is such a very special relationship with China. So you make me feel people in Muscatine so friendly to us. That's the reason why, start from 2013, my partner and I, actually we have argued, we have some debate about if we are going to do business in Iowa, even if we are going to do business in Iowa, where should we put our company, where should we put our head office in? Muscatine or Des Moines? At least Des Moines is the capital city of Iowa, right? It's a big city anyway. But finally, we say, okay, let's come here. Because it's different, because it's a typical American style life. We can find a lots of reason to support it. But I think, yeah, why not? Why Muscatine? Why not? If there's such a good place, such a friendly people, that's it. That's me, not a very good answer, but it's a real answer from the bottom of my heart.
That's a great answer. We've got that on tape for our Convention and Visitors Bureau.
Yes.
All right, so let's talk a little bit about some of the investments that you're doing here in Muscatine.
Yeah.
Specifically the new hotel, the Merrill Hotel. Mm-hmm. You and your partner have invested. I know when I talk to some of my students, I say, well, these guys are really, they're a minor investor, but you know, it's still several million dollars in the project.
Yeah.
From your perspective as an investor in the hotel, and really an investment in the tourism industry, what do you see? What are you anticipating from the tourism industry by investing in this hotel in our town?
Okay. When my partner and I, Glenn and I, we are going to do something here. Usually, in Chinese business philosophy, if we want to do some business in some place, usually before we are going to do business in here, it's better for us to do something good for here. Am I clear? Because we believe if we are going to do business here, that means we are going to make some money from here. If we are going to make money from here, it's better for us to do something good for here. That is something we are looking for, even before we invest on the hotel. We're just looking for the different, any kind of project we can do to help locally. And then the hotel project comes to us. I have to say, from the business point of view, the ROI, which is a return of investment of the hotel, is not so fancy, especially after we invest on the internet. It's a very traditional business, and we are the minority investor on that. But the reason why we invest on that is because we heard, they told me, it is the economic engine of the town. This is what I heard. And this kind of economic engine will save about $7 million expense annually in the town, which currently is leaking to the Quad City or anywhere. Okay. So this is something, what do I believe? It is. If you don't have a good facility to host your customers, your senior management, even if you are going to make a good big convention, you can find a good place. This is not good for a town. So I think, okay, I believe if it is a good economic engine, we'd like to be part of the economic engine. That's what's the originally thinking about that. The reason why the hotel, we are minority investor, but we are real important for that. The reason is because the hotel, if you count about the business about a hotel, the most important figure is the room night of the customer. If the room night of a hotel is not so good, the hotel will be collapsed. But if the room night always links to the customers, whatever, mostly is tourism. So that's the reason why we think if we can do something to bring tourism coming here to stay in the hotel, that'd be good. We pay lots of attention on that. We even do a lots of study to study to see if how many people we can bring here. Two ways we can do. First, Chinese. In last year, Chinese tourists, there's about 2.1 million Chinese tourists coming to US. About 85% or 87%. 87% of these 2 million Chinese tourists, they just stay in East Coast and West Coast. Few of them coming to Middle West. And 90% of these guys who come to Middle West, they just stay in Chicago for one night or two nights. That's it. That's the reality. But if we can do something to bring 10% of these guys who stay in Chicago coming here, or even 5%, bring them coming here, it's a big number. And personally, my partner and I, and also my wife, they like it very much, especially this kind of high-end consumer, tourism. We have been here for a long time, so we are not going to do, we are not going to spend too much time in big cities. That, since big city is a big city. New York almost seems to Paris or to Berlin, any kind of Geneva. Same, almost same. But the high end, if the high end tourism, some of them we can bring them, that's quite good for the hotel and for local, for Muscatine. And also in Chinese, from business point of view, we believe people flow equals to cash flow. So if you can bring people coming here, they will spend money in here. So people flow almost equals to cash flow. So this is the Chinese part. The second part is how to bring American tourism coming here. That's the reason why we bring the Chinese Symphony Orchestra coming here. Because from marketing, if I'm going to marketing Muscatine, from marketing point of view, the concept of differentiation is very important. What can I do to make Muscatine differentiate with the other small cities 100 miles around. Anything difference with anything of Muscatine could be difference with the others? I don't know. So that's the reason why last month we bring Chinese Symphony Orchestra coming here. I know they are good, but I don't know what is your taste. I don't know if you like that. I mean, the typical American, typical Midwest people. I don't know if you like that. I know they are the top guy, top of China. So I make it as a test. So last time it's free. I want to see if you like that. Seems you like that, quite good. So Kaya and the city, they did a lot of marketing to promote, to publicity it in Qua City, Iowa City, and in City Rapids even. So at the night, when Dan Stein and I on the stage, we count it. There's about 10% people from Iowa City and 10% of the audience from Qua City. That's about 200 audience. So this, if we can use this kind of music or any kind of art related stuff to bring these guys coming here, if these guys, these 200 people coming here, they have to take dinner in here. They have to take a hotel. Of course, I hope they can choose my hotel. They will go to, if they stay in the hotel, they will go to the bar. When they drive back home, they may need to go to the gas to take some. I mean, a lot of possibility for these guys, as long as we can bring these guys coming here. So Chinese Symphony Orchestra, it's just a market test to see if it works. And if it works, and if we can make it, we can use it as a tool to make Muscatine differentiate with the other small city, it'll be good. It'll be a kind of attraction to bring these guys coming out of Muscatine to stay here. So if it'll work, next time I may bring some Chinese Kung Fu performance. It's more popular. Or acrobatic. It's more, I mean, this is a lot of Chinese good stuff. And we have very good connection with Chinese different department, ministry. So we have these kind of resources. So if we can keep doing that regularly, such as once per 6 months or once per something, that's the kind of brand awareness of Muscatine, which is very, really differentiated with the others. So this is the tourism business. So tourism, when we talking about tourism business, it's not just like a hotel or a river or what. It's a kind of combination of something, and then keep your target audience to understand let's think about it. After 1 year, some people say, okay, if I'm going to understand some thing about China, let's go to Muscatine. Or if we can position like that, wow, that's huge. Potential consumer in the Middle West. Okay, because China is too far away for them to go there. But if they want to learn something about China, spend 2 days in here, good. Oh, my hotel will be full. And these guys coming here, they already have a lot of consumptions. That's a kind of tourism business.
Awesome. Okay, so let's shift from tourism to the other business opportunities that we've talked about that you see from the Midwest into China. Tell us some of your ideas and your plans
there. Yeah, that's another business which is the as I said. When people get rich, when people get money, they're looking for good product. They're looking for real, some high quality product. Okay. This one. This is the number of Chinese import product from worldwide in past 5 years. In past 5 years, from 2009 to 2013, in 5 years, we doubled import product from worldwide. That's mean what? That's mean the people get rich. People looking for good product. I wonder if you heard about it in China there's some problems about food quality and there's some criminals on that. So people, especially the high-end people, they are looking for good product, even if it's a little bit expensive. So they'd like to pay premium on that, okay? And they do a lot. Actually, a lot of people doing import business, export business from US to China. I understand that. But most of these guys, they stay in West and East Coast. Again, most of these guys. I just come back from LA. I met several people in there. So this is the current status. What we are going to do is, in here, in Muscatine, or in Iowa, or even in Midwest states, there's about 10 states. I've been a couple different cities, Minneapolis, blah, blah, blah. I found a lots of different products in here, which, first of all, agriculture here is very good. So that's mean a lots of food product, finished goods in Middle West will be good for China market, because I understand China market very much. So we start to think about what kind of business we can do, because I believe every entrepreneur, they want to make their business big as possible. Every entrepreneur, they realize the China market is a very big market, 1.3 billion people in there. And the market is getting bigger because people get rich. So I believe there's a lot of potential in Middle West. So I started talking with the different company, and the feedback is real good. People in here, they want to do business with China. They want to enter China market, but as a small company or middle company, they are not capable for that. Because I work for Johnson & Johnson, Kodak, blah, blah. They are multinational company. They are couple trillion business. They're a couple billion US dollar business. So they are affordable for that. But for most small and middle company, they are not affordable. But they are my target audience. I'm going to work on that. Because current situation, thank you. If a product starts from US manufacturing, if we are going to sell to China consumer, you have to go to the broker buyer, to go to the exporter in US, to go to the China importer, to go to the wholesaler, to go to the distributor, to go to the retail store, and then go to China. Each of these supply chain eat up a lot of margin. So that's the reason why this stuff, my wife likes it very much. I bought it in here $3. No, I don't forget. Okay, about $3. But in China, it's about 65 RMB, which is less than $10. Oops, see, scare him, scare it. about $10 for that. Not only because of course, there's a lots of cost, a lots of margin on that, but also a lots of cost, import, export, transportation, blah, blah. But always think about it. The demand, the consumer demand in China is keeping growth. What we need to do is how to supply them, how to fulfill their demand, to choose the best channel. So we are going to play the channel, to combine all of them together. We are going to place order from the manufacturer in US directly. Go to China distributors directly. Through retail to go to touch the consumer. We have the facility, we have the channel in China. Not for everything, but for certain category product we do have. So now, in here, we just start to establish this supply chain. When this idea comes to me about 3 weeks before, we start to practice. It's quite interesting. I need somebody help, so I asked Dan Stein to help me to design the presentation PowerPoint. Okay, And after I prepared my PowerPoint, I said, I need somebody to talk, to practice, to see if it'll work. So Dan told me, okay, you can go to he has a company. His product is stamp, which is a very bad consumer product. This is not consumer product. It's a stamp of letter. You know, this is the letter. This is stamp for military or for what? It's an industry product, but it's a very good product, and this is a very good sample for me to practice my presentation material. So I talked to the general manager. After 20 minutes presentation, the general manager, she told me, I want to be your first customer. I say no, because your product, see.
You can't get the lid back on that.
See, I say no, because your product is not my target product. What I'm going to do is the consumer finished goods. This is the best product because I know the demand in China. This one, I have no idea about that. And if you want to be my customer, he has to pay me, and he has to pay me $1,000 as a fee, and then give me $1,000 sample, the value of about $1,000 as a sample, and then I will distribute it to China to deal with the distributors. I said, no, you are not my target product. But her answer, her words to me is really impressed me. She said, yeah, I know, I'm not your target product. But as a businessman, you never know, or when you put your product into such a big market like China, you never know what will happen. Yes, it is truth. Because in China, don't forget, there's about 1.3 billion people in China. Even if very small percentage of people who want your product, it is real something. It's not a small deal. So I agree that, and I'll do that. I'll help them to bring to China, just to show to the distributors to see what will happen. And the second guy I talk with is this one. This is the potato chips stirring. I personally have no idea about that, but some people told me it's good. Actually, I feel very salt. But okay, different people have different taste. When I talk with this guy, I have to say this is also not a good product, not my target product, because this is a product which this is about $1 retail price, but this is such a big space. Hey, I have to import it, transport from US to China. The transportation cost is real something. But this guy, he told me again, almost same statement with this guy. He wants to test it. Because you don't know what happened in China. Some people want to eat it, that'll be big order to them. And this company is, I think it's about 5 to 10 million revenue a company a year. So see, even if a small company like that, they also want to expand their business. So I believe after talking with these guys and also some other guys, I feel, well, I'm full of confidence. People want to do that because people want to export to China because the market is real good. So this is something what we will pay more attention about in the next couple of years.
So how can Muscatine and Midwest businesses
get involved.
Get involved. See the opportunity and capitalize on it.
I don't know. I always just say it will totally depends on people in here if you want a job or if you want a business opportunity. What I'm going to say is if of course the hotel in here and the consumption and the tourism business in here, they'll be generate lots of different kind of jobs in here, definitely. But meanwhile, this kind of product, this kind of business, especially export to China, help these guys export to China. I believe this is something I mean, people in Muscatine, everybody has a lots of friends. Everybody has a lots of relatives. You will have friends to do the sales, a lot of people working on sales. And lots of people, maybe some people have some business or finished goods, any kind of finished goods. So people, if they can deliver this information to these guys, maybe it's a very good job, it's a very good opportunity for these guys. And this is the kind of work which you can offer to your friends or this is the kind of work you help them. This is also something you can get involved, because if people in here would like to do that, because, okay, the export business, I'm not only looking for Muscatine or even Iowa, I'm looking for the entire Midwest. So there's a lot of choice. So people, if you want to share this information to different business, any product you think is good, let them know. If they have interesting, tell me. Tell my people in here. We can talk. If people want to do that, people can get their commission, obviously. And if the business keep growing, they can got. I mean, in my understanding, this is kind of decent job. This is kind of. What I mean decent job is, besides of you can make good money and also you can deliver value to the other peoples. This kind of decent job, and also this is kind of a business opportunity instead of job only. So I believe, think about it, 5 years later, or even just 3 years later, there's 300 suppliers export their product to China through my company. And they have to ship into here, and they deliver to China, and there's a lots of business among here. So I believe this is a kind of something that people in Muscatine could be involved.
So great opportunities. What do you see as the greatest challenges over the next few years?
Yes, it is. Challenges. I don't know. I'm so positive. I always look for the opportunity. Challengers. Okay, maybe I'm seeing that way. It's, understanding and misunderstanding. Okay, yes. Maybe the kind of challenges, I always talk to my American friends that I'm Chinese, we know America much more than you know us. Of course, you are the big guy. You are the top guy. You are the superpower of the world. You're number one, so you care about you just think about America and no America. But don't forget, we are number two, okay? So it's worse for you to understand something about us, about China, because. Just in past 20 years, China economic growth like that. How about what will happen in the next 20 years? A lot of my business friends in US ask me, oh, what do you think about China economic? Currently, seems the China economic a little bit problem, blah, 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 blah. What's your comments on that? I told them, yes, I just told them China economic is just like a train. China economic is just like a huge train. When it stops, it's very difficult to push it up. But when it starts to move, it's also very difficult to make it stop. That's my understanding about China. So don't expect China economic will be shrinking. No. Yeah, it's where we keep yelling. Because this is the big company's economic. So I can anticipate the China economic growth, and if you could understand more about China and take advantage of, because Muscatine really had very good relationship with China, and we are here, we will provide more opportunities about China and here and a lot of business and export. If you know more about that, I believe you can. It's a kind of, I'm not going to say it's a kind of challenge, but it's also kind of opportunity that you can take.
Yeah, good.
Yeah.
Okay. we'll kind of wrap this part up and then we'll do some Q&A. My favorite closing question. What's the worst part about being an entrepreneur? That's the first part. And then the second part is, what's the best part about being an entrepreneur?
Good question. And my answer is, I don't know. Because I'm not the worst entrepreneur. And I'm not the best entrepreneur so far. Well, I'm going to, maybe I can, I don't know the best part of what. Maybe I can share some my experience to you.
You bet.
From my point of view, about my 20 or 20 more years experience, marketing. I like marketing very, very much, and I do believe the value of marketing. 2 points maybe I'd like to share with you. First of all, is the differentiation. Do something to make yourself differentiate with the others. It will help you to build up your competitive advantage. From my personal experience, when I started working for Johnson & Johnson, my medical background helped me a lot to make me differentiate with the other sales rep. So it gave me a lot of advantage. When I started my business, my working experience in a multinational company make me differentiate with a normal businessman. I'm well educated, I can speak English, I can, whatever you understand or not, at least I can speak. And I understand the Western style business philosophy. So, I'm going to do business in US, 99% of Chinese, they go to West Coast and East Coast. But me, I'm coming to Muscat in the Middle West. It makes me differentiate with the others as well. So I personally believe the value of differentiation could make you outstanding with the other competitors. That's the first. And second is, I truly thanks of the companies I work for. They helped me to open my eyes all of China, open my eyes on the world. So maybe I'll suggest to you, especially the kids, the students, I'd like to suggest you to open your eyes on the world, if you can, on China, because it's a second of the world. I can tell you that I've invited a lot of American people and people in here to come to China. And last year we sponsored 5 students to China. And this year we may keep sponsoring. Yes, definitely. In this year, in a couple months later, we will sponsor some students to China again. The reason why I sponsored that, I always told them that China is definitely not so bad as what you learned from US media. It is not so bad. I'm guaranteed that. So this is totally different. I have to see, any of you have been in China before? Yeah, good.
She doesn't count.
Yeah, because you don't have any idea about that. The first time I've been out of China is about 30 years before, so I went to British. It's totally different with what I learned from China media. So, eyes on world, eyes on, suggest you eyes on China. So out of box, that'd be good. That's something what I can share.
Good. All right. Let's open it up for questions. Who's got a question for Daniel?
I got one. You spoke well about the fact that you were a doctor and how you made it to here. But what I'd like to know is how you made it to be a doctor. In other words, how did you grow up? You know, was your family fluent? Were they poor? Were they, middle class, how we would count it? Or how was your upbringing to get you to a point that you knew what you wanted to do in life?
Oh, that's a good question. Actually, it's not my interest to be a doctor. After my high school, I'll go to the university. That's my dad. My father asked me to say, hey, are you going to be a doctor? I said, no, I have no any idea about that. But he said he wanted me to be a doctor. My question is why? He told me, I have a quite big family in China. We have about 100 people. You know, big, it's a real big family. My father, he has about 8 brothers. And my mom, she has about 9 brothers and sisters. So it's a big family. And one reason is my dad told me, okay, in my big family, we have businessmen and teachers and officers, blah, blah, blah. But no anyone who works for the hospital, whatever, nurse or doctor. So maybe you can be a doctor and serve our family. I think good. Yes, it's a good reason. So I go there. But after 6 years, I feel real bad about that. So I want to be out, quit. But my dad is good as well. He just told me, yeah, go ahead. Okay, he asked me why. I said, yes, this is the reason. Too much bureaucratic, and I don't want to be a doctor. I don't want to be a doctor. I don't want to be a good and rich doctor after 20 or 30 years. Okay, the doctor is, when we're getting older, you can make good money. I said, no, I'm young. I need money now. I feel bad. I'm sorry, but I need it. I have to date. So my dad is good enough. He said, okay, follow your heart. If you want that, you do that. And that's your choice. And I pay for all of your bill in 6 years. Tell me, when can you pay me back? I said, yes, I cannot pay you back within doctor very soon, but I will do it if I'm visiting. So that's it, yeah.
Well, yes.
Yeah.
I heard nothing about the Communist Party. What's your relationship, your background? Do you need to work with party?
What, Communist Party?
Communist Party.
Communist Party, China?
Yeah, your connections, does it get in your way? Does it help?
No, I'm not a Communist Party. You mean the Communist Party? I'm not a member of that.
The ruling party. I mean,
what's that?
So does
I just want to know if it's a factor in your life.
Does the ruling party and the government get in the way of your business dealings?
Or help,
sure.
No, nothing. Nothing. It's all of that is my private business. The four previous multinational company. That's a joint venture company. That's a Johnson Johnson make a joint venture with a local Chinese company. But this is dominated by. But these guys they are minority investor. They take huge percentage of the share, and I work for them. I work for these guys. And then that's my private business. No any, but not very few connection with the government and officers. They do a lot of monitoring, blah, 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 but that's
well, and I think, I'm guessing, Dan, where your question may be coming from is what you had said to us that we don't know enough about China.
Yeah.
We think
yeah.
we do,
yeah.
and it's what we hear from the American media. And so you suggest.
Go ahead. Any question? Go ahead. Yeah.
Yourselves. And,
yeah.
Yeah.
So. So in China we have we call it a state-owned company. Do you know that? That's mean that the company is owned by the government, state-owned. But all of that, this is the company which owned by that. Such as this one, the Johnson & Johnson, they take home almost 90% of the share of the company. And that company, that's all of the private owned. That's a private owned company. Yeah. Yeah.
So with China's growth in economics, I know also in the past 20 years, you guys have managed to get a lot of trade agreements, specifically, I think, recently. 10 years ago with Australia, 30 years ago, I believe, with the U.S. but do you deal with companies where you don't have free trade agreements and there's tariffs and taxes between trading with countries? And have you had to overcome any of that?
I'm not so clarified, but can you say it again? What's your question?
Like with U.S. and China, we have a free trade agreement. So like we can sell you goods and you can sell us goods without a tariff.
Okay, yes, yeah.
Like a tax by
yes.
the country.
Yeah, yeah.
Are there countries that you deal with where you do have taxes that you have to deal with where you...
I don't know. Because I don't have too many import export experience. No, I just focus in China market, domestic market. The reason why I'm going to do this export business is because I know about China market. Actually, I know what they want. I know which is good product, which is not good product. Okay, and I don't know the distribution channel. And I know the demand is over there. You know, as a business, I always think about, okay, as a business, it's always about some demand and supplier. And compared with these two parts, demand is more important. So if we find demand is over there, the rest is how to fulfill their demand. And then supplier in here, whatever in California or in Middle West, you have this kind of supplier. Why we not do that? So that's the, if we do that, this is the first time we do imported business. That's it. But that'll be fine because I'll find some professional people working for me on that. This is technical issues. Oh. What I need to do, my decision, business decision is this the kind of business what we should focus on? If yes, why? So the answer is demand is over there. Think about how to make this supply to fulfill their demand. That's what we should do. And the rest we will leave to the professional people working on that.
Okay. Curtis, you have one?
It kind of got answered.
Okay.
Could you tell us a little bit about your animation business and what that
is? Yes. Animation business, actually we were very active in about 10 years before. Because don't forget Glad, he started from toy. He started his business toy about then, 10 years before. He make his first money about toy. And then if you are doing toy business, if you are going to sell with the primary price or more quantity, you have to make a story for the toy. And the best way to make a story for toy is in cartoon. Disney is very good at that. So we start to do that. And then he make it a good money again. He start to invest on a movie. Probably glad he's the first guy in China who invest. You use private money to invest on the cartoon animation movie. But he invest on the movie and you can make money by yourself. But he will buy all the right to make toys. And then he make money from toys. That's his way. When we met Eden, at that time, because I'm working for, because I have this experience. So, and I know some story about Disney. So I understand the value for the animation, the value for the character is not only for the toy. It's also for any kind of product. This is kind of, we call it license business. Same like that. Superman, is this Superman? Yes, Superman. So maybe maybe Disney, I don't know who owned this. Walt Disney, or Warner Brothers. So maybe Warner Brothers charged this about 1 cent. But that's about huge amount of that. So this is a business what I'm looking at, I'm good at. I want to do that. So I start my business of cartoon animation is not producing cartoon animation. I started my business in this kind of license business. So I got the Kung Fu Panda license in China. Kung Fu Panda 2. Do you know that? Kung Fu Panda, yeah. I got a license from DreamWorks, yes. And then I sell it in China. I sell it to Glad for the toys. I sell it to lots of this kind of fast-moving FMCG product. charged them very, very few percent, but actually got quite good return. So that's my business. And then we met together. He knows about how to make money by toy, and I knows how to make money by the license. So we working together to invest on the movie, invest on, we pick some good cartoon and invest on that. That's work.
Now I have another question.
Go ahead.
Say more about the story of the president of China who visited Muscatine, Iowa in the 1980s, and the story unfolds from there. And you have a corner on that story.
Yes. That's something, I mean, yeah, because president China is totally different to like what's president in here. It is a, you know, this is a, yeah, maybe you really don't understand why our president regard Muscatine so good. That's 1985. China just opened. Not even did they open the market. They just start to open eyes to look all of China. And don't forget, our president, he came here 1985. That's his first time go out of China. It's first time go out of China. He went to America, which is the biggest enemy of China at that moment. This is so scared. He comes here. It's such a, just like some people can do, yeah, even just like 2 years before we sponsor some, we bring some people to China. They write me an email to ask me lots of questions, very detailed questions, and some of the questions, real stupid questions about what they need to do prepared. But think about back to 30 years before, president come, first time he go out of China, come to US, and scared so much. But when he stay here, you guys host him so good. You host him so good. So when he come back in 2012, he said, you never know what kind of impression you leave to me. To me, you're America. I believe that's the word from his bottom, from the bottom of his heart. Cause the first time I went to British, when I landing in London airport, when I get out of the airport, I'm going to take a taxi. I don't know how to call a taxi. I even cannot find where is the taxi. And lots of guys come to see me, hey, come on to my car, blah, blah. Scared. At that time, he just about 32 years old. He's still a young boy. He's scared. But you guys take care about him so much. That's I believe that's the reason why he come back at that time.
That's a good story.
That's a very good story. So from my point of view, when we come in here, this is a good story. And this house is a part of that story. And we have chance to own that. Why not? And when we own that, I don't know what can we do on that. I have no any idea. Glad, not me, Glad comes to buy here. He came into here in 2013, about May. He come here, bought a house. Call me, buddy, I bought a house. I said, no, what am I going to do? He said, no, I don't know, but please come to take a look. I said, no way. Every year, because he knows, every year I spend 1 month in Seattle with my brother-in-law, he's staying in Seattle. So I bring my family, stay in Seattle 1 month for my vacation. He said, oh, you will be here at July. Can you come here? I said, no, because I'm going to boating, I'm going to sailing, I'm going to fishing, lots of sea works. He said, okay, come on, take a look. And then I come here. Come here, I just did one night, but real good. So that's it. If it is good stuff, let's do something on that. But even if we don't have any plan, but we can do something. We can, yeah, buy it. And then see, after that, we do a lot of work based on that. It's good. Yes.
All right, when the orchestra came here, Did we repeat the thing? Did we do it again for them?
Or yeah.
Did they have fun? Was this a good experience for them?
Very good.
See, I told you.
Did
yes.
we have to learn anything from it? I mean, do they have any suggestions on how we can do better?
Yes, they do. My people, the lady over there, she has helped me to collect a lot of stories and lots of feedbacks from them. They love you very much.
Okay, they had a good time.
They had a very good time. Then I have to tell you that the first time they be here, they scared. They cannot speak English. They have to stay with you, whom they never met. And every people to people, we have different behavior, different habit, cultural, lots of different. And when the first time I told them, hey, are you going? I asked them, are you going to stay with the hotel or a host family? No answer. No answer. It's quite scary. Why? And then 1 week later, Stephanie write email to them again. Hey, can you tell me what are you going to do? Stay in hotel, let me know. Make a list, put in hotel. Want to stay in the host family? We will do something for you. No answer. Okay, now I understand them. They're struggling. They want to stay in the host family, but they're scared about it. They don't know how to do that. But later, before they leave, two guys told me he has been, two of them, they have been about 70 countries of the world because they are top players in China. All of the countries, a lot of countries invite them to play over there. But he told me he never stay in a host family. He never stay with the local people. So he told me, I'm so familiar with the airport and hotel and the auditorium. And that's all. But in here, see, they made one performance in Chicago. From landing, hotel, rehearsal in auditorium, back to hotel, sleep, auditorium performance, back to hotel, sleep. The next day, take on a bus, Detroit. Auditorium play, rehearsal, back to hotel, rest, place again, to Muscatine. That's it. So that's their normal life. So they told me that I have been a lot of country, but I just have been a lot of countries, auditorium and hotel and airport. But this time, they really have a very good, very rich experience in here. They love here. They love very much. Some of them, they write letters, thanks letters to the host families, ask my people to translate it. So they are very touched. And I personally, I'm so happy. I thanks the city and the sky, you did a lot. You give them very good memory about Muscatine. And I believe most of them, they will come back personally with their family for their vacation. That's another reason why we need the hotel built up as quick as possible. They are rich guys. Yeah. So that first of all, that's good. And because this is so good, actually, we are going to do that one more, or even more. Some people already start to talking with us to see anything you can do because people like that. And if you like it, we will do it. And some people from Des Moines call me that. Hey, I know that. Are you going to? But of course, next time maybe one performance in Muscatine, maybe one performance in Des Moines as well. Yeah. So it's good.
Any more questions? Okay. Well, before we do that, Dan, I have
started a bit of a tradition for Startup Grind. So my favorite quote from Steve Jobs was, I just want to make a ding in the universe. And so I always like to give you a token and say thank you for sharing your ding with us.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm so happy. Please, thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you all. Thank you, Ben.